You're listening to Tech Forward. I'm your host, Cheryl Chotrani. I'm a tech founder, developer, investor, and an industry enthusiast, and I believe that diversity can transform businesses and improve the world we live in. The Tech Forward podcast is a place for tech entrepreneurs, executives, venture capitalists, and diversity champions to share their stories, insights, and visions of the future. Together, we'll discuss the path to improving representation for women, minorities, and other underrepresented groups. What challenges, strategies, and possible solutions will shape the road ahead? Let's find out together. Hello, listeners. Welcome to another amazing episode of Tech Forward. On today's show, we have Kevin Dedner, founder and CEO of Henry Health. Henry Health's mobile app provides self-care and mental health support through culturally sensitive teletherapy, serving the population with the lowest life expectancy in the U.S., Black men. Kevin is an experienced public health leader, and through his new venture, Henry Health, he is committed to leveraging the power of technology to add 10 years to the life expectancy of Black men within the next 25 years by focusing on their emotional and mental health. Kevin will be sharing with us some of the challenges Black men face in receiving mental health support and how his product will help address that need. It's going to be a fascinating conversation. So let's jump right in. Hi, Kevin. Welcome to the show. Thank you for joining me today.
Oh, thank you for having me. It's such a delight to join you.
Well, first, I'd like to start out by just talking a little bit about your journey. I understand you had a long career focusing on public health and public policy. So what was the inspiration behind Henry Health?
That is a really loaded question. I would, start out by just saying I think that, my entire career has prepared me for the work that I'm doing now with Henry Health. But being an entrepreneur is not something that's new to me. I've been a social entrepreneur for the last 7 years, and I started out consulting in the public health space about 7 years ago, really doing a lot of thought leadership work around a number of public health issues. I was doing a lot of work for the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, which happens to be the nation's largest public health foundation. But it was 5 years ago that I started to think about the emotional and mental health of Black men. And at that time, I knew that I wanted to do something around the emotional and mental health of Black men, but didn't know that, Henry Health would be in my future. And through a series of life events, including a period of my very own depression, I guess you can say Henry Health was born.
So one of the premises behind the product and the company is that Black men are less likely to seek and receive mental health care. So what are some of the reasons for that and the factors that make it necessary for a product like yours to exist?
Yeah, so I'd also like to back up a bit and try to frame out the problem from a public health perspective. And that is to say, I mentioned, it was 5 years ago that I started to think about the emotional and mental health of Black men. And the trigger of sort of this space for me intellectually was actually a point of pain. And that was the George Zimmerman verdict on literally made me sick. It gave me like really bad headaches. And so after my headaches subsided, I started to think about this question around the stress associated with being a Black man. And like I set out to answer that question from an intellectual and somewhat academic standpoint. I really wanted to understand what a stress associated with being a Black man did to our health. And I dug deep into the literature and came to an understanding about, what unmanaged stress and untreated mental health issues was doing to like the quality of life and to the longevity of life for Black men. Black men happen to have the lowest life expectancy of any population. In public health, we use this term, the social determinants of health, meaning these are things that produce, how healthy you are. And my sort of research led me to understand that stress, unmanaged stress, and untreated mental health issues are at the core of one of the reasons why Black men have a low life expectancy. And so, you know, from that place of understanding, I knew that I wanted to focus on this issue, not even knowing that I would experience depression myself and arrive at a deeper understanding of like how we approach and solve this problem. But I guess after providing like that explanation of how I want to kind of frame up our understanding of this problem, you know, obviously there's a lot of barriers associated with seeking care. But, you know, what I would say is I often now find myself pushing back on that narrative that it's hard to compel men to seek care. In fact, you know, I've interviewed over 100 men since the beginning of the year. And what I have discovered is that people are looking for real solutions, and people have actually gone out looking for solutions and not found the help that they needed. And so one of the visions of, you know, what we want to build in Henry Health is that we want to become the trusted source for providing mental health services and self-care support for Black men.
That's so important. And I'm so glad that you're working on that, because it's critical that Black men and people of all underrepresented groups get the care and support that they need. So talk a little bit about your product and how it will work. What are some of the things that the users will be able to do once they go into the product? And how is Henry Health going to help overcome some of those barriers that you talked about?
So, you know, I should just, you know, say this for your listeners to help people really fully appreciate where we are. We're launching a pilot here in the Washington, D.C. metro area. So men who live in Maryland, Virginia, or the District of Columbia will be able to participate in our pilot, which we expect to run throughout the end of the year. And so we start from this place of providing teletherapy. And not only just teletherapy, but culturally competent teletherapy. So we've designed a training for the therapists who will be on our platform that helps them understand the unique experience of a Black man in America. So men who come to our platform can be assured that the therapist who they will encounter will understand them, will understand their experiences that they're having on a daily basis in this country. And so, you know, at the core of what we provide is culturally sensitive teletherapy. We'll also have online groups that men can join that will be moderated by a licensed therapist. And these groups may cover a wide variety of topics, from everything from, you know, stress in the workplace to single parenting, relationship issues, you know, all these different sort of groups to help men navigate life. But people shouldn't stay in therapy forever. In fact, the data shows that the average person is in therapy for about 6 months. And so what we envision as a company is being able, after men sort of transition out of care, that they will then begin to leverage our app to help them better manage their health in general. And so we call that self-care support. And so, you know, the vision is that the app will be able to support men in making like better decisions around things like diet, physical activity, setting reasonable goals, and really, you know, looking at how do we leverage technology to support men in making constant daily decisions and managing their health. You know, if I'd imagine, you know, you're sitting at your desk right now recording this interview, but your phone is probably just a few steps away from you, if not sitting next to you, right?
Right.
So with that understanding, you know, we want to help men leverage that device, which is such a part of their daily life. You know, use that device to help them make better decisions, to improve their quality of life and to improve their health. And when I'm talking about health now, I'm really talking about health in a broader terms of health, meaning we're talking bigger than mental health now. We're talking about, you know, your physical health, your whole health, realizing that even what you eat, are you sleeping right? All of these things even impact your mental health.
Of course, they're all intertwined. So yeah, absolutely. One definitely feeds into the other. So you mentioned culturally competent therapy, which is, I think, really important. Obviously, you spoke a little bit about your own personal experience dealing with mental health issues and seeking therapy for yourself. So I'd love to just kind of get your perspective on your role as the leader and entrepreneur launching this product, coming from a place of empathy and having firsthand knowledge of what your users and eventual customers are going through. How important is that to you? And how do you think that you've been able to kind of leverage your firsthand knowledge of the audience to build a better product and service?
You know, that's a really loaded question.
Yeah, of course.
And one that, candidly, I pause in to collect my thoughts about how I respond, because 5 years ago, when I came to an intellectual understanding of what unmanaged stress and untreated mental health disorders was doing to Black men and their quality of life, I did not have the full emotional understanding that I have now, because I had not experienced it for myself. And when I came to that understanding, I was so committed to the idea that I literally bought the domain What's Killing Black Men, thinking I would write a book about unmanaged stress and untreated mental health issues and how that was at the core of poor health outcomes for Black men. But I had not had the experience I had of depression, right? So I tease my friends and I say, you know, I made that commitment, but I was ill-equipped at the time. And I believe that God heard me and the universe heard me. I have, you know, whatever language you use to describe a supreme power, but I was heard, but I was ill-equipped at the time. So I had to have the experience that I had to be able to lead a group of people who are all committed to getting a product out there for men, but who have not had the experience themselves. Even my therapist, my former therapist, who's now our chief clinical officer, doesn't have the perspective I have, because he was on the other side of the table, right?
Yeah.
So,
right.
And I'm grateful for him. I'm incredibly grateful. That statement is not meant to take anything away from him. Obviously, I put a lot of confidence in him, because I sort of credit him with helping me get my life back on track. But what you're talking about is having empathy and having an understanding, a heart for what men are experiencing. And that's one of the things that is one of the reasons why I continue to talk with men every day. I've built it into my schedule to interview at least one man a week to talk about what he's experiencing, because I don't want to get too far away from a real understanding of what people are experiencing. So the product is built with that in mind. Like, here's the good news is that, you know, in tech, it's all about user experience. It's all about discovery and figuring out what people want, what people need. And, you know, with this, we don't ever want to get too far away from that. Like, we want to always be listening to men and understanding what they're experiencing on a daily basis.
Amazing. Well, you know, one of the things that we've talked a lot about on this show is how, with the lack of funding or limited funding that goes to entrepreneurs from underrepresented backgrounds, it results in there being fewer products that are addressing the real needs of these populations. And so I'm so glad that you've taken this on and that you've been able to really advance such a much needed product and service. So thank you for that. So I'd love to just talk about your experience now of being an entrepreneur and what it's been like from the moment that you had the idea and decided you were going to launch this product. Like, what has the journey been like? And what, if anything, has been surprising to you, or any challenges that you might have faced, and how have you overcome that?
Wow. You know, that's a loaded question. I appreciate that. I appreciate being challenged. But, you know, I think my entrepreneurship journey is really a mirror of life, right? That we're all going to have these experiences. I remember when I first started, you know, to really think about what I could do around emotional and mental health. There was a lot of resistance. I was going out, making the case to, I was doing a lot of work in philanthropy and trying to convince people, oh, you know, hey, here's a real problem that you should invest in. And I was just met with deaf ears, right? And, you know, people didn't want to get behind the idea, but I felt deep down inside that it was an idea that needed to be discussed. And I didn't know what the solution would look like, candidly. It wasn't until my co-founder, Oliver, who is an angel investor and who had been working in tech, he reached out to me and said, hey, I see the things you post. I really want to do something in tech. You seem like somebody I could work with. Like, could we do something together? And, you know, we sit down and it was like magic instantly, right? But that wasn't the moment that everything came together. Even after that, after it crystallized that there was a way to move forward, to took everything that I had experienced and learned, that there was a way to move forward and build a product that could help other people. Like, my suffering could be redemptive for others. When I realized that, I did have a new motivation to move forward. But then again, I was met with resistance, like people, investors, like, oh, that won't work. You can't scale. You can't make any money that way. People wouldn't return our phone calls. But here's what I've found is that you're met with initial resistance. And if you can push through that resistance, you will find the support that you need to advance the idea. And that's what I've learned as an entrepreneur. You know, I think entrepreneurs, we learn this. This is the way life works. And a lot of us are more in tune with it than the average person. Like, you know, you're going to always be met with this initial resistance. But if you can push through that resistance, you will find the support, the enablers that you need to move the idea forward. And so that's been the story of Henry Health. I mean, we're at a point now that we've developed a whole new ecosystem of friends and supporters who are rallying behind this idea that of our company. It's essentially an idea, but it's an audacious idea. You know, as a company, we've set a goal, we call it our moonshot, of adding 10 years to the life expectancy of Black men within the next 25 years. That is a moonshot that people are jumping to get behind. But every now and then we still meet resistance, but we know that there are people out there who support this big goal that we have. And because of that, we can push through the resistance.
Amazing. Well, you found your tribe, which is great.
Absolutely.
So you shared a blog post on your site recently that talked about the effect of social media in perpetuating some of the mental health issues that Black men face. So talk a little bit about that and kind of the role of social media in affecting that and what Black men can do about that. And if there are any positive aspects of social media that can be used to promote mental health.
Yeah, it was actually my colleague, Dr. Jones. She's recently gotten married, so I'm trying to make myself, you know, say her new last name. But we've been talking and thinking about this for a long time. And I think it's really important in the era that we're living in that people monitor what they take in and what they consume. We started thinking about this years ago when the invention of cell phones started sharing all of these videos of like police brutality and, you know, just in general fights and all of this stuff that people share on social media. And I think that oftentimes people don't connect the dots of what that does to us emotionally when we take in that footage, those images. And so as a company, we really want to be a thought leader around mental health and emotional issues. And, you know, part of, I think, what, you know, Dr. Jones was trying to communicate is that we have to watch what we take in because it does impact us emotionally. And, you know, one of the things I think that's clear about even these videos with police brutality, I think it's raised the awareness of like what's going on. But we also run the risk of desensitizing ourselves of it. And then also the other thing that happens is subconsciously, as like Black men, we know that that can happen to us, right? Or even my 12-year-old, like I actually literally, there are times when I'm going out at night, my kids will say to me, are you really going out this late? And it's more of a protective thing because they see these images of what can happen to me, right?
Yeah, and so, I think about that with my son. I mean, he's only 5, but 5-10 more years from now, he's going to be a young man.
Absolutely, and so think about this too. So what we argue is that there is a weight, a stress associated with just being a Black man, right? Mm-hmm. Period. And so when you take in like too much of these images of what happened, I'm not saying that you totally go mute to what's going on in the world, but I am saying that you have to be really careful because the mind is an incredible organ, right? It is just, and if you're taking that in subconsciously, you know, you're also taking in how you fit into this world and what that means for you. So we caution people on being really careful about your intake of social media. I make it a point, you know, I'll just tell you, I'm aware of what's going on in the world, but there's no need for me to watch the police shootings or, you know, beatings. I don't need to take that in, but I am aware of what's going on.
Now, are there any ways that social media can be used for positive effect for mental health?
I think so. You know, one of the things that we're going to be doing as a company, in fact, I don't know if you may remember Dr. Dennis Kimbrough, but Dr. Dennis Kimbrough was really popular in the late 90s. He did like a lot of motivational speaking. He actually wrote a book, Daily Positive African-American Affirmations. But we recently were able to strike an agreement with Dr. Kimbrough to provide like daily motivational messages to our users. So that will actually be, you know, one of our free services that we'll be offering for people who download our app is these daily motivational messages from Dr. Dennis Kimbrough. And a quick Google will help you fully appreciate his work, but he's amazing in so many ways. So, you know, sharing positive messages, affirmations, the research shows that these things really play a tremendous role in like people's current condition and mental state.
Amazing. Well, what's next for Henry Health? Where would you like to see the company go from here?
I want to get this MVP out. We're launching our seed round. So we're trying to find the right investor to help us scale and get a product out there to the masses. You know, we've been met with a lot of interest and I would say demand that people are really looking and anxious for this product. And obviously, I'm from the South and my home church back in the country, the preacher used to say the gospel is free, but it costs to pump the pump, right? So, you know, so what we have to figure out how to do is raise money to scale our vision, to get a product out there that, you know, realizes the potential. Like, I'm absolutely convinced that, you know, we can reach our moonshot of adding 10 years to the life expectancy of Black men, that we can help men live a better quality of life. We can help them manage their stress. And so, you know, the big deal is like getting the tech to pace this vision that we have as a company.
Yeah, well, I'm so inspired by that vision and just can't wait to see all the success that you'll have and definitely look forward to hearing more. So what is the best way for our listeners to connect with you and to learn more about Henry Health?
I am on Twitter and Instagram at @KDedner. The company is Henry Health App on both of those platforms as well. And if users would like to email us, they can email us at hello@henry-health.com.
Well, thank you so much for your time. It's really been a pleasure speaking with you.
Oh, it's been my pleasure. And thank you and your listeners for the opportunity.
For all of you out there listening, thank you so much for joining me this week. You can find the links to everything we talked about today in my show notes at goodbiteventures.com. If you have any questions, comments, or feedback, please reach out to me on Twitter at @TechForwardPod or on Instagram at @TechForwardPodcast. Remember, you can also connect with me by signing up for my newsletter at goodbiteventures.com/tech-forward-podcast. That's bite with a Y. If you enjoy the Tech Forward podcast, please share a link with your friends over on the social media channels where you're most active. Also, please do consider writing a review of the show on iTunes or wherever you subscribe to the show. Reviews and social shares are one of the best ways for new listeners to find us. Thank you again for listening. See you next week.